Super. Se shodneme. Tak Dino. Dear Mr. Kumar, ladies and gentlemen, let me to welcome you to a lecture by the Japanese architect Kengo Kuma. We are delighted that the famous world architect accepted our invitation and also that continues our cooperation, which began at the International Conference Architecture Outside the Centers, which we jointly organized with the Faculty of the Architecture and Art in Technical University in Liberec in more than 10 years ago. Our temporary joint project has several levels. After the lecture will be open an exhibition, and in courtyard you can see the results of the international student workshop. And final project will be the realization of the pavilion or tea house for the National Gallery in Prague next year. Today's lectures held in cooperation with Faculty of the Architecture in Technical University in Prague. And now I would like to invite for here for the floor Dean Ladislav Lábus for the welcome speech.
Dear guests, dear friends of good architecture, dear friends of modern architecture, dear friends of Japanese architecture, I am pleased to welcome you in this place, in this historical place of Czech Technical University, in the Bethlehem Chapel. And I welcome here, of course, the main person of this evening, Mr. Kuma.
Before giving the floor for the Professor Kratochvíl, I would like to thank our partners and sponsors. The Ministry of the Culture of Czech Republic, Prague City, Prague One, State Culture Fund, Czech Architecture Foundation, Prague Three, National Gallery in Prague, AED Project, Hala, Architect, Šiko, Subterra, Karlín Group, Bamboo Design, GTB and all media partners. And now I would like to invite for the introduction speech Professor Kratochvíl for Faculty of the Architecture and Art in Technical University in Liberec.
Dear Professor Kengo Kuma, it's a great honor for me to welcome you here in Prague. And I apologize that I will speak Czech to our Czech audience, but I promise that my introduction will be very short and I will translate it to you then later in the evening. Dámy a pánové, je pro mě velkou ctí, že mohu tady přivítat pana profesora Kengo Kumu, protože jste všichni zvědaví na něj a nikoliv na mě jako na třetího předskokana. Tak slibuju, že budu mluvit opravdu velmi stručně a krásně bych pana architekta představil. Narodil se v roce 1954 v Yokohamě a kde si zmínil, že pro něj bylo dost podstatné, že dětství strávil v tradičním japonském dřevěném domě a nikoliv v betonové krabici. Vystudoval architekturu v Tokiu, později strávil 2 roky též na Kolumbijské univerzitě a též získal později titul PhD, co svědčí o jeho trvalém zájmu o teoretické uvažování, které se promítlo i do řady jeho teoretických úvah, publikací, esejů. Dnes vyučuje na Tokijské univerzitě, na fakultě architektury, kde se věnuje nejen výuce, ale také výzkumu spolu se svými studenty. Samozřejmě, že pro nás všechny je nejzajímavější jako tvůrčí architekt. Svůj první ateliér otevřel v roce 1990 Dnes už vede 4 ateliéry, nebo 4 pobočky svého ateliéru v Tokiu, Pekingu, Šanghaji a v Paříži. A jeho stavby jsou rozesety nejen po celém Japonsku a v Asii, zejména třeba v Číně, ale mnoho realizací má také v Evropě, zejména v poslední době v Paříži, ve Francii, i ve Švýcarsku. A pokud vím, tak jednu vilu též postavil a realizoval v USA. Pan architekt Kengo Kuma byl zde poprvé před 2 lety na konferenci v Liberci a tehdejší svoji přednášku zahájil připomínkou českého architekta dlouhodobě působícího v Japonsku Antonína Raimonda. A tato připomínka jistě nebyla jen zdvořilostní frází, protože Raimond, jak všichni víte, byl architektem, který se pokoušel přemostit tradici japonské architektury a moderní evropskou architekturu. A tady je zřejmá paralela i s tím, oč se snaží celoživotně pan architekt Kengo Kuma. Tohleto propojování japonské architektonické tradice a moderní architektury není jen v té, řekněme, viditelné povrchní stránce v častém používání tradičních materiálů jako bambusu, dřevěných konstrukcí, rýžového papíru, ale spíše v tom základním, v tom pojetí architektury, které už Raimond viděl jako základ japonské tradice a viděl v ní i předobraz moderní architektury, to znamená architektury vnímané především jako tvorbu a prostoru, architektury, která hraje, se snaží propojit exteriér, interiér, která vnímá velice silně krajinu a světlo. Jedna z významných prací teoretických Kengo Kumy se jmenuje Antiobjekt a již v tomto názvu je zřejmé, že jemu šlo o architekturu, která klade důraz na stavbu jako tvorbu místa, na kontext, nikoliv na monument, který činí a krajinu ovládá. Tohoto záměru dosahuje mnoha různými prostředky, jeden z nich bývá označován v návaznosti na impresionismus nebo pointilismus francouzského malířství, jako partikularismus nebo architektura, která rozkládá stavbu do drobnějších částic, které nemají být ani tak nositeli celkového tvaru nebo ústrojnými částmi celkového tvaru, ale spíše základem emocionální reakce. Mnohé jeho stavby splývají s krajinou, dokonce v ní i mizí, často třeba hovoří metaforicky o stavbě jako duze nebo mraku. Tyto rysy architektury Kengo Kumy jsme mohli, a mnozí z vás jste si mohli nastudovat na jeho drobnějších pracích z toho ranějšího období, ale výstava, kterou za chvilku také uvidíte, bude pozoruhodná tím, že uvidíte velice recentní stavby a stavby velice velkého měřítka a nejen v krajinném prostředí, ale i v prostředí městském. A bude zajímavé vidět, jak ty kvality, které pan architekt Kuma sleduje celý život, jak se mu daří přesazovat do většího měřítka a do jiného urbánního kontextu, ale to už přenechám na něm. Děkuji vám za pozornost.
Thank you very much for the kind introductions. I cannot understand, but I understand the basic as a idea behind this, the words. As anyway, today as a it's great honor for me to as a speak in the beautiful space. It's this amazing space. I want to show some new ideas in the very historical place. As always, tradition and history is the basis of my creation. But at the same time, I would like to add something to the great history. As I prepare many slides here today, I want to start from this project. This project was built in Ishinomaki City, and Ishinomaki City was very much destroyed by tsunami at 2011. And probably you know the what happened in 2011. The upper north area of Japan was very much destroyed. And this city, Ishinomaki, was 60% of the town area was destroyed by tsunami. And many people died in that city. But luckily, this building was not damaged because I tried to preserve nature as possible, and I tried to respect nature as possible. And because, probably, because of that as a idea, nature save our building. The basic idea of this building is how to merge building into environment. So I call this idea urban architecture, so weave architectures with environment. And the title of the exhibition is organizing next to this building is urban. The basic idea behind the exhibition is how to weave nature and architecture. And this building is a good example of that kind of idea. The building is becoming a part of the environment, part of nature. And actually, one third of the building is on the ground. Two-thirds of the building is buried in the bank beside the river. This is a plan. This is a section. And that actually tsunami hits that building from right side of the building. This is the entrance of the building. Those wooden houses were destroyed by tsunami. But because of the section of the building was not destroyed. The basic idea of the building is a frame, kind of frame, the frame of the painting. Probably you can understand the ideas from these pictures. Building is a frame to see the beautiful nature, and the building is not isolated object. And I like these pictures, but the architectural magazine didn't like that picture because for them this is pictures of nature, but I thought the nature is a protagonist of this project, and architecture is not protagonist. This is a view from river. And the next project is also built in the devastated area. But luckily, this building was not damaged as well. The basic idea for that building is to use local material. The wood, the roof is covered by wood from the forest behind the building. And the silhouette of the building is very simple. One story simple building, just one hole in the center. I want to explain the meaning of the center, central hole. So this shows the basic idea. So you see the mountain behind the building. And this is the main road which connect to Tokyo. This is a typical layout of the village of Japan. The mountain and the road, and this is the center of the village, And the village center is always sitting at the edge of the mountain, because the people's life was totally depending on the natural resources of mountain. For example, the material of the buildings came from the mountain, and energy came from the mountain. They didn't have gas company as electric companies, as most of the energy came from mountain. And also the agriculture the depended on the natural resources of the mountain. Without the clean water of the mountain, they cannot do agriculture, farming. And their life totally relied on the mountain. And then they built shrine at the edge of the mountain. The shrine was very important. Shrine was a great big message. If we destroy mountain, we cannot survive anymore. That is a message behind the shrine. But unfortunately, in 20th century, the people forgotten the mountain. So because Tokyo was everything come from Tokyo, and then they forgotten the mountains, or they abandoned the shrine, actually. And there's my message behind my museum, as I designed this museum, is look at the mountain again, remember the mountain again, that is the message. And then I cut the building to create the hole. And before going to the building, people should look at the shrine, look at the mountain. And I want to show the hole again. So this hole is connecting mountain and city, mountain and town. And this hole is very important, most important part. But as before designing this building, the story is the mayor of the village made this parking lot, big parking lot, and he planned to have the entrance here. And I said, no, so if we have the entrance here on the parking side, the mountainside became backside. And then the people never go to the mountain. So this will be very bad for the community. And then finally, we can persuade him. This is a hole which connects mountain and the village. And this is the entrance facing mountainside. And material-wise, so I use the local material as possible. Wood and rice papers and the stones all came from the mountain. I tried to create super juxtaposition. So most of the units is transparent, and then we can create that kind of super juxtaposition between nature and building. And the bamboo is also very important material. As I showed you in the pavilion, I love bamboo. But bamboo is not same simple, easy material. In that project, I use bamboo here. It's an injected column. We injected, I will show you, the concrete and steel into bamboo trunk. And then it's a traditional material, but at the same time, we try to combine the contemporary technology with traditional material. This is the first bamboo house we did in Japan. As most of the architectural element was made by bamboo. Floors, partition, ceiling, all made by bamboo. And this white element is made by rice paper. And next project is by bamboo is a project in China. This is a very unique site. The Great Wall is here. As also the topography here is very steep. We try to preserve the topography. The building is following the topography, and we can save the landscape. The Great Wall, part of the Great Wall is here. And here in the center of the building, we design the tea house. And tea is very important in Asian culture. So tea is a kind of a conversation between nature and human. And then so we have the tea house in the center of the building. This is a tea house we designed. And in the center of the building, so we have this void. In Japanese culture, the void is very important. So in music, in Japanese music, so we the call void between between notes, the ma. The ma is between between notes, between sounds and between notes. And also in the space design, that we designed ma between element. And also for the wood, we are using the very thin sticks to create the transparent ma space. The hint is coming from the toy of wood. So this toy is very unique, has a very unique system. Without using any glue or sticks, combining those three sticks, we can create anything. The system is like that. Just turn it so we can finish it. We brought those sticks from Japan to Milan. My student, actually the student, built that house, that pavilion. We didn't use glue or sticks, we can transport, we take apart easily, and we can move back, we transport this element back to Japan easily. And after coming back to Japan, we decide to make permanent building by the same system. We tested this system in the university level, and this is this shows the process to make the 10 meters building. Those tiny sticks, actually dimension is 6 centimeters by 6 centimeters sections, can achieve 10 meters high building. This is a result of the building. Without any column, without any beam, only these tiny sticks are supporting the building. This is a ceiling. Look up the ceiling like that. And the next project is make the bigger the structure by the similar system. This is the bridge in the forest. And our idea is always assemble the small units to make the bigger composition. Because the smallness is very important for human. such small unit and the small human body that can create harmony, can create conversation. If the concrete, if we use concrete, that kind of conversation cannot happen, because concrete is very heavy, very big, is very cold, but wood is very different, warm and soft, and the softness is very similar to human body. And then I decided to use wood as possible as can. This is the interior of the bridge. People can stay in the bridge. They can exhibit something in the bridge. And then it is not just a bridge. It is a multifunctional structure in the forest. In the same village, we designed the small hotel inspired by those tea houses. Traditionally, the people using this small as a hut for the cafe in the town. I use the same material, thatch block for the wall, for the facade. This is not cladding on the concrete. The thatch is very good material for insulation, and we can control temperature and humidity of the space by using this as old material. This is the thatch block we use for the facade, and this is the interior. And as we are selling the vegetable from the town, and then we call it the marché, the hotel marché, because we are selling the vegetable here. The next project, we worked with a very unique client, Starbucks. We normally work with the local people, but there's this case, the location is in front of the very old, the 10th century's temple. The Starbucks came to us to design his experimental shop. This is a temple, 10th century, and this is a Starbucks shop. So I want to show the technique of Japanese carpenters, and in that building, the technique of joinery is more complicated. These sticks are supporting the building. This is not a decoration. This is a structural joint. And those sticks are supporting the building. And we also try to use a local wood from the forest. And after we finished the Starbucks project, some new client came to us. It's a Sunny Hills, is a pineapple cake company, pineapple. And the cake is made by pineapple from Taiwan. Want to show their philosophy in that building, that they are only using organic natural material, I like that idea very much, and then I decided to use this similar system as Starbucks. But it's a more difficult project because it's a three-story building supported only by that tiny stick, 6 centimeters by 6 centimeters, the joint. The diagram shows the process of construction. The system of the disjointly is called the hell joint. Is in Japanese, jigoku gumi. The meaning of hell joint is once we assembled, never as take apart. And then if I drop to hell, never come back, that's the meaning of that hell joint. But this system is simple. It's a three layers joint system. And the two-layer joint system is not strong because it's a slidable. But if we add one extra layers, so we can never take apart. And then the interior is becoming like forest. The effect of light is in the night time. And the next project is we are using the more natural element. It's a chapel called the Birch and Moss Chapel. It was built in Karizawa Forest, and Karizawa is very famous for birch forest. And the building was supported by the trunk of birch and also surrounded by forest of birch. This shows the section of the building. And the glass church is surrounded by birch forest. And then exterior and interior, the border disappears. And also for the floors, so we try to create continuities of the most outside and most inside. And the furniture, those are made by acrylic and transparent as possible, and then so we can create continuity of exterior and interior. And so go back to the city. Go back to Tokyo, another special location in front of the old temple. I love this kind of space in the temple. The people are selling very interesting items in front of the temple. It's a Japanese tradition. Temple is not separated. Temple is a part of the life, and the people are selling and buying in the temple. And this is a project that is proposed for that site. It's a 40 meters building, but it looks like the one-story buildings are stacking up to seven-story. It's a section of the building. So my idea is for each floor, so people can feel like living in the one-story wooden building. And also the advantage of this section is providing those triangular space for machines, mechanical. This is a rendering for the composition, and this is the actual image of the building. So we use the wood for the facade, and wood for the interior. And the small theaters on the fifth floors of the building, and the rooftop terrace. And this building is the highest tower in Tokyo, the 600 meters. It is not bad, but I prefer this wooden building. And in a different context, in Europe, we are doing the similar idea. We are realizing a similar idea. This is a project for Besançon in France. The site is like that. Site is also sitting between nature and the city. And our idea is same as the museum we designed in Japan. Building is a gate which connects nature and the city again. And also we try to preserve the old brick building. And old brick building, and we add as a simple wooden structure on the wooden building. The rivers and the city is in between. It's working as a gate which connects natures and the city again. And the materials came from the mountain. It's the same as our Japanese project. In that case, we use larch from the mountain, and also we designed this semi-covered space. In Japanese traditional architectures, we call this kind of in-between space engawa. The engawa is a beautiful space. It's always between building and gardens. It is semi-covered. There's a wind. We can feel winds and natural light in engawa space. And also in France, engawa space is working very well. People like this covered space, and we also designed this as a biotope, this creek, and also we designed this section. This is another engawa space, in between space, and also it is a semi-outdoor space, so with a special effect of natural light. So we try to create atmosphere of the forest in the artificial building. That's another natural light effect. And the space between the existing old brick building and new building. And the rooftop is covered by vegetation and photovoltaic panels. And as another French project is in Marseille. It's a Fond Légion d'Art Contemporain. It's a contemporary art center. So we try to find the local material in Marseille. And finally, I could find the small glass factory, which is producing recycled glass. This white stuff, this white one, is a recycled glass, made from the used glass. And the effect is very soft. A normal building, a normal museum, is covered by the brick or stones or that kind of heavy material, but this building is semi-transparent by using this kind of the translucent material. This is a terrace on the rooftop. And the night time, this translucent materials can get that effect. In the center of Paris, we design the Entrepot McDonald's, but McDonald's is not hamburger shop. This is McDonald's, name of the street in Paris. This is the McDonald's Boulevard, and this is the building. The building was built 1970s for the warehouse, big warehouse in the Paris. The master plan by OMA is proposing the preservation of the building and add the boxes on the rooftop. Other five French architects adding boxes, concrete boxes on the concrete boxes. But my part is different. My solution is different. My solution is to add light, as a wooden roof on top of the concrete box. So I want to create the softness in the city of Paris. This is a roof we add on the concrete box. The program of the business building is a community centers, and including the junior high school and high school and the sports centers. So for that kind of community program, I think wood is most appropriate material. And the people can feel wood here, behind the roof. And also interior, we use wood as possible as can. And this is a court as a courtyard for high school, and the wood, and those panels we use the zinc panels. The zinc is very popular in Paris, a traditional material in Paris, and we combine zinc and wood in the same building. As a people in Paris told me that this roof reminds them the origami, holding papers. As always people to try to connect the Japanese tradition and my design. But this holding is not coming from Japanese tradition. I try to give the gestures to every the neighbors, and eventually we can get this as a kind of different angle. And next is a project in Spain is an opera house in Granada. For this project, I try to get a hint from the shape of the flutes, the pomegranate. The name of Granada came from the name of the fruits. We study the structure of the fruits, and this hexagonal structures is very good for as a structural solution for the big opera house. And another hint of the building is Alhambra Palace in Granada. We did a research about the structural system of Alhambra Palace, and we can find this similar geometry in Alhambra Palace. We try to create the kind of big flutes by the same system. This is the flutes we designed. And those hexagonal structures is very good for creating the bigger interior space. This is the interior of the opera house. And 1,500 seats, but each unit is 50 or 60 feet seats, can fill the human space. So we try to cut big pieces into the smaller cell, the same as our pavilion. The small unit, small element, that create harmony between human. And for the project of Victoria Albert Museum in Scotland, Dundee, it's a Victoria Albert in London, but this is a site for the new museum. So we try to create a harmony with this beautiful cliff. This is my first sketch. And this is a site plan. The building is merging into the river. This is my idea. In 20th centuries, the building is isolated from environment, but as always, I try to create conversation. This is the whole. So again, the whole is to connect nature and the city. And as a building is like the bridge, or building is like the whole. As a Heidegger, probably you know, as a philosopher Heidegger, so he defined architecture is a kind of bridge. I like his definitions about architecture. So before him, the people thought architecture is towers, or architecture is a monument. But as Heidegger, as Martin Heidegger said, architecture is a bridge which connects two things. So I like that idea very much. And in that case, this museum is connecting nature and town, like that. And besides those bigger projects, so we are doing the small pavilion, like the pavilion in Black Plague. And always, so we try to experiment something in the pavilion. In case of that pavilion, we use this Italian stone, so working with Italian stone as a artisan, but we try to slice the stone as possible. The thickness of the stones we can minimize as up to 1 centimeter, so like paper. And stone papers is creating this building. This is a pavilion. The Italian craftsman could achieve that. And the achievement of that paper, the stone paper pavilion, is translated to aluminum. This is aluminum as aluminum shelf system. This is very light, and I believe that this lightness can fit the context of Japanese traditional town. This town has a beautiful interior space as well. And that this as a shelf system can be merging into this traditional townscape. The joinery of the pavilions. And after making that pavilion, so we designed one small house, aluminum house, by the same system, because this joinery is strong enough to support the building. And the good thing for this aluminum system is flexibility. So we can create those as multiple sections by one single system. And again, the student built that system by themselves. It's a part of our education. So my dream is make architecture as democratic as possible. And in 20th century, the only big company can produce concrete building. But in 21st century, in 22nd century, the people themselves should build the house by themselves. And that is my dream. And then I push the student to build by themselves, to think by themselves, and to build by themselves. This is interior. The one single unit system that can create anything. Kitchen and furniture as anything was made by a single system, single unit. As it is similar to the human body. The human body as a one cell system that can create as any organs. Looks different, but the basis of organs as a one single system. As that system is applied to the interior design of the boutique. The joint system is very similar, but the material, the panels is different, and then we can achieve that organic space. And the next translation is going to ceramic monument. Made by the ceramic tiles, but the ceramic tiles is used for structural element, not cladding. And normally, so we have the concrete structures cladded by tile. I don't like that kind of superficial solution. And for this project, so we worked with structural engineers, and he said, the contemporary ceramic tiles is strong enough to support the building. And those white tiles is supporting this monument. And so another strange episode after that is so one driver, one drunken driver, hit that monument by his car. The monument was broken, but he survived because of this is not concrete. The police said, if you use concrete, so he never survived. But because of this light structures, that drunken driver survived. And the monument was reconstructed by the insurance, and then everybody are happy. By it. the idea, the monument by the ceramic, is translated into that museum. The facade of that museum is made by the ceramic tiles in China. The ceramic tiles in China is still handmade, and the color is beautiful, and has a natural diversity, natural roughness. I decided to use that material. This is a detail to how to suspend the ceramic tile. And this is interior. And this is another part of the building. Another museum in China as I recently built was like that. This is a one-story building. The floor is following the topography of the hill. And this geometry is very helpful to follow the complex topography. As a covered, the roof is covered by the reused ceramic tiles. And also we designed those screens made by the same material. It looks like the old Chinese painting, but the technology-wise, it's made by the stainless wire suspension system. And next pavilion is called K by K, It's a collaboration with a champagne company, the Klug, you know, the special champagne company. As a story, is a strange episode. Is the first time I met with Oliver Klug, the owner of the company. He said, the Klug champagne is not necessary to be cold, he said. The warm champagne is also very good. It's a very unique story. Warm champagne, I can't imagine the warm champagne, but he said, for some meat, the warm champagne will fit better. And then I got this idea. The temperature is a basic concept of this pavilion. If it's warm, it has a unique shape. And if it is cold, it can have another shape. And then we find the special material, the temperature memory alloy. So in the certain temperature, it can have the hardness. In other temperatures, it can become soft. And then the shape of the building is moving, always moving. Most of the movable architectures has electric system, as a machine shift system. But this as a movable pavilions is moving because of the nature of material. That is a big difference. It's similar to the body of human. And another pavilion made for Italian Milan Triennale is called Casa Umbrella. It's an umbrella pavilion. The umbrella is a unit of this pavilion. The theme of this pavilion is the house for disaster, catastrophe. And my proposal is, if everybody can carry this special umbrella, the people can build their own pavilion by themselves. As if disaster happens, earthquake happens, tsunami happens, we should learn with the umbrella. And we should learn with the umbrella like that. And if we can find the friends, we can build the pavilion like that. So this is the interior of the pavilion. It's just bigger enough. It's big enough. It's 15 people. By the calculation of the geometry, the 15th umbrella is the best number to make the pavilion. It's the same as the calculation by Buckminster Fuller. So Fuller also proposed a 15th as a facet, 15 facets of the pavilion. So it's the same. And the joint is much simpler than Buckminster Fuller. It's a zipper. The waterproof zipper is used for the joint. And actually, the student who built the pavilion stay night in the pavilions. They drink together. And they stay here, so it's big enough for 15 students. The next material is the poly tank, the polyethylene tank, which is usually used for the construction site. As a good thing for this system is control weight by water. So if we fill the water, so it can be heavy. If we want to carry, we flow the water out. It's just for the MoMA exhibition, the form delivery. So my idea is a form, deliverable form by using this unit. We designed this special unit, and the the uniqueness of this unit is two bulbs in one unit. And if we have two bulbs, so we can get the flow of waters in the wall. The water is flowing in the wall and in the floor. And that means if we can have this as a heat collectors, as a hot waters, heated waters, that can flow in the wall and in the floor. This is it shows a system. In the 20th century building, the structure is structures, piping is piping, and finish is finishing, all separated. But actually human body is not separated. It's one singular system. And this is the same. And in the wall, we can get the flow of waters, and it is a very efficient system for heating. This is a house we completed. One single cell can create anything. The bathtub and the kitchen and the bed is all made by one single system. And then also every unit can be heated and the electric system is like that. It is not as connected with infrastructure. The infrastructure is actually not so reliable. In tsunami happens, as an earthquake happens, every infrastructure system was cut. Independency is very important for the future house. And then this is the basic idea of this pavilion is independency, is autonomy of each house. After that completion of that house, we designed a tea house in China, in Beijing. This is permanent building. This is not temporary building. It's a permanent house in the center of Beijing. This is a section, and this is interior. And this is window. This is not painting. The neighbors is that building is Forbidden Palace in Beijing. It's very, very special location. And the building is supported by this polytank. And the effect of light is very unique by the use of this material. This is outside. This is a kind of historical street, and we should have the roof on top of the polyethylene tank. But it's very different from traditional building, but the Chinese government gave us a permission. Yeah, this shows the location. Neighbor is a Forbidden Palace. As a Frankfurt, designed tea house by membrane. We call it the instant tea house. In 15 minutes, we could make this balloon. It's a double skin structure, and double skin is supporting the building. This is the interior. That is a tea house, and we have tatami mats and fire in the center. And we translated that idea as more instant building. It's a National Building Museum in Washington, D.C. state. It's just a floating tea house. I like the fabric, because fabric is light, and is very soft to human bodies. But for architecture, the people didn't use that material for a long time. But the very famous the architectural architects, Zemper, is a Siegfried Zemper. He wrote the book about the history of architecture, and he said the weave is a very important the method for construction. And then I tried to go back to the fabric as possible. This is another the pavilion made by the membrane. We use the small the unit by membrane. The furniture is also made by membranes. Finally, we could use the membrane for the main material for the house in the Hokkaido area. Hokkaido is up the very north in Japan. In the winter times, the temperature dropped up to -30, -40 degrees. But this house has no insulation material. The double skin, between the double skins, so we have the circulated airs, hot airs. That circulated hot airs can control the temperature of the interior. And I tested by myself, -30 degrees. I slept here, but I still can survive in the -30 degrees without insulation. And this project, we use a magnet, special magnet for the joint. And this is a pavilion. This is a magnet. We didn't use any boards. Only magnet is for the joinery. And we use the three screws. And the three, as a basic idea is the three screws in a different direction of sticks that can combine together to create the solid, rigid wall. This is a process. The three screws, the combined, fixed together to create the hard wall. This is the result. And the three layers, you see the magnet. The three layers of membranes stick together to create solidness. And this is a paper pavilions in Milan. And the paper itself is soft, but if we twisted the papers, the paper become a kind of semi-solid, semi-rigid as a property. This is the interior of the paper pavilion. As the most transparent materials we use is a very light bamboo sticks. This bamboo sticks is usually used for fragrance. But we use this bamboo stick for structure of the pavilion. And of course, we combined with the fragrance. The bottle is here, and the liquid of the fragrance is going up to the top of the pavilions so that we can get a special the smell in the space. And this is a pavilion. And that kind of light material also can be used for structural reinforcement. This is the old building, but structurally it was weak, and we need structural reinforcement against the seismic. But the material we use is not steel. It's a carbon fiber. It shows us our structural reinforcement. And those carbon fibers is connecting us and the building. This is a detail of carbon fiber. As of also, the roof and the earth are fixed by those carbon fibers. And for stretching, the strength of carbon fiber is 7 times stronger than steel. Very light, but 7 times stronger than steel. This is the interior of this building. Most of the interior made by fiber and fabric. And we tried to create same kind of feeling for Olympic Stadium 2020 in Japan. So made by wood as possible as can, and to create harmony with environment, put the vegetation in the building. The same idea of the old temple. This kind of section is protecting wood from as a tough climate. Most of Japanese old building has this section. The layers of roofs, the protecting structure from the rain and light, and we have the same idea. And also the natural ventilation as possible as can from those slit. And also try to use the forest from devastated area. Earthquake, tsunami, and those red zones are destroyed. And we try to use the forest, the wood from those areas. And also the new recycled materials are combined with wood. And finally, we can go back to Prague. The bamboo, the pavilion, we are designing in Prague. But this is our first idea. And the bamboo pointed out, bamboo is not related with Czech. But the story is the Antonín Raymond is in between Japan, Czechoslovakia. The Antonín Raymond, do you know that great architect? He was born in Czech, and he came to Japan, and he was a kind of great pioneer of Japanese modern architecture. And you know Kenzo Tange? Kenzo Tange was working for Antonín Raymond when he was young. And most of major Japanese architects in that generation worked for Antonín Raymond, because he was a real pioneer of modern design. And Antonín Raymond liked the bamboo very much. And also he likes the roof design very much. He likes the Japanese local material, the bamboo wood, and also he likes the roof of Japanese buildings. And I was influenced by him very much. This is a kind of bridge between the Czech tradition and Japanese tradition. Then, as I decided to use bamboo for the pavilion plaque. This is a process of developing the detail of bamboo. I feel the bamboo is between the wood and fabric. The softness of the bamboo is similar to the fabric, but at the same time, bamboo is a kind of wood. Through the pavilion project, I want to create a kind of bridge between Czech and Japan and the West and East. Thank you very much.
Mr. Kuma, thank you very much for your lecture. Dámy a pánové, nemáme moc času, možná 5 minut na otázky. Já myslím teda, že bylo řečeno hodně, hodně uvidíte i na výstavě. Potřebujeme jít, aby jsme byli ve 9:45 v galerii, protože přijde japonský velvyslanec. Takže maybe we have time for 2 questions. Takže kdo bude první, takže pokud jsou otázky. A myslím, že Petr, takže the first question, this is the question about the pavilion, the location of the pavilion in the Prague. For the first steps was the location in Prague 3, this is also the picture with this location, but now it's discussed to move this idea to the Štemberský palace, because in 2018, will be in this palace the collection of Asia art, and we would like to build this pavilion in this part of the Prague or the National Gallery. We will see tomorrow, and this evening has the director of the National Gallery the meeting with Kengo Kuma. I hope this pavilion will be next year in Prague. The other question? Better? No? Okay. Oh.
Já jsem se chtěl zeptat na jako takový pojetí vlastně času. Já to můžu říct anglicky, nebo můžu to říct nejdřív česky. Okay. So I wanted to ask about the building seemed to me very light and sort of ephemeral. And I wanted to ask about the sort of concept of time, because they almost seem like sort of temporary structures. Even the sort of solid buildings seem almost temporary. So I wanted to ask about that aspect of your work.
Yeah, I think the maintenance is very important. How to design the long life is very important for every building, I also think. please remind the Japanese temple, Horyuji Temple, built in the 7th century. It is the oldest wooden building, 1,400 years life. And why it has become possible? The because of the maintenance system. The roof is has that section, and wood is protected, and at the same time, the door's material is visible. And if the one the unit is damaged, the people can replace easily, and then that kind of long life can be possible. But concrete is very different. The concrete looks like permanent, but actually, the life of the concrete is now the maximum 100 years or something like that. And the replace is very difficult for concrete. If some part is damaged, we can rebuild, we can demolish and rebuild. So this is the destiny of the concrete. The wood is different. And also the carbon fibers can be the very long life. And the new material, in 20th century, people believed the concrete is permanent material forever, so it's permanently strong, but it's not true. So we should find some new material which can maintenance easily, replace easily, can have a long, long life. That is my goal.
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your coming. And we are going to open the exhibition. After the exhibition, we can also offer the small refreshment with the sushi, maki, and the Czech wine.